Amen. I better turn this on or I will forget. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord of glory. Is that over there? The only reason I do that is so it doesn't look like it's coming out of my head or something. Hallelujah. Who's blessed?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We are really blessed. Amen. Amen. Because of what Jesus has done. You know, I've entitled this message, I call it Developing a Taste for Grace. Developing a Taste for Grace. My really good friend, Pastor Mark Burroughs, I've been listening to some of his excellent teaching from Huntsville, Alabama. If you remember Pastor Mark, he shared here, great guy, great minister, full of the word. But he shared something that I thought was really, really powerful. He talked about how we have physical taste buds. We all know that, correct? But he says, you know, you have spiritual taste buds. You have soulish or emotional taste buds. And I was thinking about that as I pondered that, and I started thinking about, for example, coffee. Coffee doesn't taste good usually when you just drink it. But how many know, to many of us, coffee is really good? Why is that? Because we've developed a taste for it. And you know, you could do it with whatever, but I'm just saying, you develop a taste for something. And you know, we know, understand that in the physical, but what about in the spiritual things of God? Now, when I say grace, I know many people view grace as just license, or you know, you don't have any responsibility, but that's not grace at all. In fact, Scripture warns of people that would turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. I want to give you another definition of grace that I thought was so good. I don't even know forget where I got it. I think, but it's really good. I've defined grace as God's ability given to us on an unearned, undeserved basis. That's good. Now, I know most people define it as unmerited favor, undeserved favor, and it is all that. But listen to this. This is good. Grace, the complete favor of God that makes you a recipient of all of His benefits. The complete favor of God that makes you a recipient of all of His benefits. Grace. The complete favor of God that makes you a recipient of all of His benefits. That's awesome. That's the grace of God. But you know, when I say that, you know, grace, we talked about how out of Romans chapter 5, verse 21, how God's grace reigns through righteousness, reigns through understanding who you are, which we're going to get into today. But what I want you to understand is that, how do I want to say this? That as you develop a taste for grace, it begins by understanding who you are. All right. Amen?
Amen.
But before you understand who you are, you need to first understand who He is.
Okay.
Once you understand who He is, you begin to understand who you are, and you begin to respond to who He is. Let me show you this verse of Scripture, Psalm 34, verse 8. Oh, this is going to get good, people. This is going to get good. Hallelujah. Do you know if you never look in the mirror, you'll never know how good looking you are?
That's right.
I mean, maybe with, you know, all the girls whistling at you and, you know, all that stuff, you're vice versa, hopefully. Just I throw that out. Anyhow, but look at this. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in Him. This verse is so loaded, it's amazing. You got to taste before you see. What are you tasting and seeing? That the Lord is good. You know, a lot of times we say God is good, and everybody, all the time, because you know we've been trained to say that. But is that a revelation to our heart?
There you go.
Amen.
There you go.
Is it a revelation to my heart? God is good. God is good. But see, if you never taste His goodness, and you taste His goodness through the Word, you'll never see it. And if you don't taste it and you don't see it, you won't be blessed in the sense that you trust in Him.
That's right.
You know what's a blessing? It's to know that God's got your back. He's got your side. He's got your front. He's got all of you. That's a blessing. Amen. Let me show you another one. I want to jump over to 1 Peter chapter 2. And I want to show you verse 3, and then we'll jump back. I want to just show you this quickly. It says, if so be that you tasted that the Lord is gracious. There it is again. He's talking about tasting. We're talking about developing a taste for grace. Or what I would call, you could call it your spiritual taste buds.
That's it. Amen?
Amen. But it says, if so be that you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Back up one verse. Let's just look at this. There's more in this context. Eventually, we'll probably be back to this in another message. But it says, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Now leave that up there for. Now what he's saying here is just like a baby desires the sincere milk. The word sincere means the pure milk. That means the uncontaminated milk. Amen? The spiritual milk. Those are all accurate definitions for what sincere means there. See, it's the pure milk of God's word that causes you to grow thereby. Now that look at the next verse now. If so be that you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. What is gracious? That He's good. Are you seeing the connection? See, it's in tasting that God is good. That's what causes you to grow. You know, I know people that have been saved for years, and I've been there, done that, and got the shirt, where you were saved for years, but there really wasn't the joy of your salvation. All this joy that people talked about, it seemed to elude you. And it's not that I'll use myself as an example. It's not that I didn't love God. And I'm speaking for multitudes. They love the Lord, but they're not experiencing everything that Jesus has made available. Number one, they need to understand who He is. And I'm going to say this to you real clear. I've said it before. God is good even when you're not.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
God is good even when you're not. Boy, you got to get that. You got to get that. And see, and people don't understand. Let me say this to you. Anything that God asks you to do is already something that you've received. God doesn't ask you to do anything that you haven't first received. See, a lot of people don't know that. And so they're trying to do something to be something that they already are. Boy, it's good news, people. Amen? Well, okay. Well, so this is the key. And back up one more time to verse 2. I just want to... It says, just like newborn babes desire the pure, uncontaminated, sincere, spiritual milk of the word, that they may grow thereby. But see, the reason that a lot of people don't have that desire is that they have not tasted that God is gracious or God is good. They've heard about it, but they haven't tasted it.
Big difference. Amen.
Do you know if you realize how much God loves you? I'll give you an example. Remember that thought, because I'm going to come back to that. Wow. But like Thursday night with the healing school, I mean, there's so much good. I was lamenting that more people weren't here to avail. Not because you have to. We don't even take up an offering. Okay. All right. But I was doing that because I just want everyone to hear it. I just want you well. I just want me well. That's my heart. It has nothing to do with getting... You know, if we want people in these seats, we can just cut out cardboard copy or things and just sit them in there. And then we go, John Heidfield. No, I'm just kidding. I just did that because I heard him laugh. but I believe, and here again, I understand. This is not condemning. I don't mean it like that. But I'm saying that you couldn't keep me out of the word when I find out how much God loves me. You can't keep me away from God when I find out He never rejects me. I mean, God knows all about you and still loves you. You know, that's the definition of a friend, or one of the definitions. Someone who knows all about you and they're still your friend. Amen.
Amen.
God is beyond that. He's so much better than that. But my point is when we taste that God is gracious, we're just like that newborn babe. We just desire the things of God because we've tasted. This is where life is at.
Excellent.
You know the life that God gives you, literally, zoe in Greek, literally means to be possessed of vitality. Possessed of life. Possessed of zeal. Possessed of excitement. Possessed of everything the world looks for. Amen? Amen. All right. So the first point the first thing I want to talk about in developing a spiritual hunger, number one, and I've just mentioned it, is we need to see who God is. We need to taste and see who God is. But in seeing who God is, we need to see who we are. When you look into the mirror of God's Word, let me tell you who you look like. You look just like Jesus in the Spirit. Amen. Now, we've talked about this, but I'm going to show you specifically in the Word of God what you look like. This is good. It's going to get real good. Look at 1 John 4:17. I know we all know it, but let's look at it anyhow. I'll tell you what. We'll do this one. Herein is our love, literally the love He put in us, made perfect or complete, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Now, the day of judgment, hear me, is not just some glad morning. The day of judgment is when anything comes your way that Jesus has already been judged for, like sickness. Amen?
Amen.
Are you hearing me? Like the desire to just lose control of myself and get mad and blow up and road rage. And I mean, when I grew up, I never even heard what road rage was. I mean, I can think back to the day when I thought gay meant happy.
Yeah.
I learned it on the Flintstones. We'll have a gay old time. I thought that meant happy. I remember one day at school, somebody said, oh, there's another meaning to that. I said, really? What could that possibly be? Happier? We're moving right along. So having boldness in the day of judgment is when anything comes your way that Jesus has already been judged for, you have boldness. Why? Because His love has been perfected in your heart. Amen. His love has been perfected in your heart. Now, why is that? Because as He, referring to Jesus, as He is, so are we in this world. Now listen, if the day of judgment, think with me on this, if the day of judgment that He's talking about here was just future, then why would He have to say in this world? Think about it. If He's talking about just a future judgment, then what's that got to do with how I am in this world? Amen. Well, and the next verse talks about fear. We'll just do that one. There is no fear in love. None. But perfect love, which is God's love for us, cast out fear. We talked about this last week. His perfect love cast out fear because fear is torment. Torment. He that feareth has not been perfected in love. All right. Now, what do we look like in the Spirit? Let me give you another one. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11. Let's look at this one. This is why I get so good. I'm excited. We are going to cover it. Look at this. We're going to cover it. I know we are. For both he that sanctifieth or sets apart, say that's Jesus. Watch this. And they who are sanctified, say that's us, are all of one. For which cause he's not ashamed to call them brethren. The word brethren in Greek is the Greek word adelphos, and it literally means from the same womb. Isn't that powerful? So now, here's what he's saying. Both the one who sanctifies us, that would be Jesus and what he did, and us who have been set apart or sanctified, we're all of one. So he's not ashamed to say we're from the same womb. Amen. Good stuff. And one more, and we won't go there, but I will just say, well, let's go there. I want you to see it. 1 Corinthians 6:17. I've mentioned this one a lot, but you need to see it. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. So if you've been born again, you're one spirit. One spirit. Hes in Greek, which means one to the exclusion of another. One. Amen? But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Say, are you born again? This is how God sees you. God sees you as perfect. Now, I want to show you this. And let's jump over to Galatians 5, because there's a couple different places here. Verse 19. Let's just do 19. And we just want to do the beginning of 19. And then we'll jump to 22. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest. They're open. They're common knowledge. Now, stop. Notice he says the works are the works of the flesh. What is flesh? According to the book of Galatians, flesh primarily has to do with self-trust. So notice he says works. Everybody say works. ergon in Greek. Now jump down to verse 22 of Galatians 5. But the fruit of the Spirit is. Notice he says fruit of the Spirit, and he contrasts that with works of the flesh. Why? Works imply effort. Fruit implies life. Now, if we really understood who we were, hear me, we would realize that it's difficult for me as a child of God to sin. Are you hearing me? Well, why is it so easy? We don't know who we are. All sin for a born-again believer is just a case of mistaken identity. That's all it is. But if we really understood that, it would be difficult for me to blow up and go into, because it isn't who I am. Amen. So what is the life of God? It's being possessed of His vitality. That's what you have. Amen. Amen. Notice it says the fruit of the Spirit, and he contrasts that with the works of the flesh in verse 19. But this is what I want to delve on. What do you look like in the Spirit? It's described right here. The church for so long has made the fruit of the Spirit a work of the flesh. How do we do that? Let me give you an example. We're going to have a seminar on the 7 steps to how to love your wife. According to the Bible, I don't have to do anything to get love. If I'm born again, I've already got it. But if I start teaching you to do something that you already are, I'm making it a work of the flesh. So now you're trying to do something to be what you already are in the Spirit. You see, God's not trying to make you into anything. He's merely trying to reveal what you already are. Or I like to say it this way. If we knew better, we'd do better. Amen. See, if we understood who we were, we'd do better. And we all have this struggle, including yours truly. I know. Sorry, Mark, you thought I was perfect. I've been telling him that for so long, he's finally believing it. I'm kidding. Now think about this. But I want you and I to see, what is the fruit of the Spirit? First of all, notice it's fruit, not fruits. That's big. In the Greek, it's the Greek word karpos, and it's singular. It's singular. It's not plural. It's singular. The fruit of, there's 9 attributes of the fruit of the Spirit. In fact, I believe that when it lists the first fruit of the Spirit, love, I believe the rest of the things that it goes on and says are just descriptions of love. How do you know that? Well, you can go over to the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, and read verses 4 through 8, and you'll see a lot of these characteristics like long-suffering listed there. But see, we need to know what these things look like. Hear me. Before we can begin to walk in. Before we go through this, I want you to look at this in the Amplified Bible, verses 22 and 23, and then we'll come back here. And we'll begin to describe each one of these so we can see this is not something you have to do to be. This is something that if you're born again, you've already got it. You got to get that. You got to get that. Anyhow. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Now, when we talk about the character of God and the fruit of the Spirit is merely God's character manifested through your born-again nature. It's the work of the Holy Spirit manifested through you. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which His presence within us accomplishes. Now, I got to say this, because people say, no, it's the fruit of your born-again Spirit. It's the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Listen, he that is joined unto the Lord is one Spirit. Amen? It's the Holy Spirit's influence upon your born-again spirit, and as you allow that to manifest through you, that's what it's talking about. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which His presence within accomplishes, boy, we could camp here. You know the church sings some dumb songs, not here, sometimes. More love, more power, more of you in my life. And I think God, one guy said, he says, you know, if God could be confused, he would be confused. I think I give him my presence. I think I gave him my love. I think I gave him my power. He's already given. Now, I understand if you're saying more to manifest in my life. I get it, but that's not what's being said. Many times we sing these songs and we're asking God to give us more of what he's already given us. We try to usher in the presence of the Lord. Listen, I got news for you. The presence of the Lord is already here. Because I'm here and He lives in me. And if you're born again, you're here and He lives in you. Amen. You don't have to get God to come somewhere. He's already in you. Well, we got to be God inside minded. Hello, new covenant. See, in the old covenant, you had to go to the temple and to the priest and to do all this, and the God's presence would show up in the Holy of Holies, and there was a veil and all that stuff. But now you're the temple. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which His presence within us accomplishes, is love, joy, gladness, peace, patience, and even temper, forbearance, kindness, goodness, benevolence, faithfulness. Next verse. Gentleness, meekness, humility, self-control, self-restraint. Against such things there is no law that can bring a charge. Now back to verse 22 in the King James. I want to go through all these things, and I think it will really bless you. Amen? The first thing he lists here is love. And as I said earlier, I believe that love is not something you get, it's something you are if you're born again. And that all the other eight attributes that he describes here are all descriptions of the love of God. But what are these things? Let me say this, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on love just because I believe the other things are going to be descriptions further. But I want to say this. In the Greek, there's different words for love. Did you know that? There's agape, which is the God kind of love. It's based on who God is. And that's the love that's been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. But then there's phileo. Phileo is the friendship kind of love. That you like someone, it begins with P-H-I-L-E-O, I believe is how you spell it. And that's the love that, you know, you're my friend, a phileo, there's an affection. Then there's eros. Eros is physical attraction. It's not even in the New Testament, where it's just all about self. And then there's another one I wrote down in 2 Timothy 3:3 that has to do, it's without natural affection, is a storgos, which means without natural or social family affection. Without any, you know, it's another type of love. So I'm saying all that to say, I love you with God's kind of love, but you know, I have a different love for my wife than I do you. Why are you saying that? Because some people say, oh, we just love, 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 and we drive around in a flowered Volkswagen van and play 8-track tapes of the Partridge Family. Some of you don't even remember 8-track tapes are. Okay, well. But no, there are different types of love. We need to understand that. But what he's talking about here is God's kind of love, agape. And then he goes on to describe it. Now, this gets really good. First of all, before I move on, I want to give you two verses in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. Watch this. And we'll come right back here. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth, now, back up. Beloved, let us love one another. Let us love one another. You remember the fruit of the Spirit or the vegetables of the Spirit? Lettuce? I'm sorry. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is two things. Everybody say two things. Number one, he's born again. He's born of God. And number two, he knows God. You know the reason there's a love problem in the body of Christ? And I'm talking about people that are truly born again. They don't know God. You can't know God and not love people. It's impossible. And we're going to see what that love looks like as we see who we look like in the Spirit. Amen? It's impossible to know God, to be born again and know God and not love people. Totally impossible. Isn't that amazing? So that's why we keep telling you who you are. Who you are is who He is. That sounds like blasphemy, doesn't it? Who I am is who Jesus... I didn't say it, He said it. He put me in Him. Now jump one more verse. Watch this. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. If I don't love, I don't know God. Amen. Simple. So what's the answer? To try to love more? No, to know God. Amen? That's the answer. See, if I make the answer, if I give you the wrong answer for the test, if you will, and tell you, well, you just need to know God more. Or excuse me, you just need to love more. If I tell you just need to love more, and you're out there trying to love more, you're not going to love. You're just going to fail. That's why so many people, how many people have you hurt in your life if you've been saved any number of years? I tried the Christian thing. It just didn't work. Just didn't work. I tried. That's the problem. You tried. See, Christianity is not about you getting stronger and stronger. It's about you getting weaker and weaker in yourself to where all you do is trust Him. We've had it backwards. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Now jump back to Galatians 5. Whew, hallelujah. Galatians chapter number 5. This is going to get good. Let's look at the next one. I believe this is a description of the love of God. Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the Spirit, remember, fruit is a result of life. You know, you read in Scripture stuff like the fruit of the womb. Like somebody has a child. Do you know that fruit is a result of relationship? Do I need to explain that more? Amen? Having a child is a result of intimacy. Amen? Having a child is a result of intimacy. Amen? That's what the fruit of the Spirit is. We have relationship with God, we produce. No relationship with God, we don't produce. Jump over to, I'm going to give you one here. Jump over to 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10. I want to show you this. You know, over the years, there's been a lot of people trying to get unity in every town you can think of. You know what I'm talking about? I'll just use this town, for example, Greenville. Oh, we're going to have unity thing. We're going to get all the preachers together and everybody, and we're going to have a unity supper. How's that working for us? It can't work. Because you can't, it's got to be a thing of the Spirit. It's got to be a thing of the heart. Now watch this. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. This is God's desire. And that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. The word judgment literally means opinion. That's God's desire. Now. But you know it's connected to the preceding verse? Did you know that? Look at verse 9. God is faithful. Who's faithful? Thank you. By whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now I beseech you. Do you hear that? You can't take verse 10 without verse 9. I know people that do. I've witnessed to a lot of Jehovah's Witnesses, and they'll take verse 10 there and they'll say, see, we have unity worldwide. I look them right in the eye and say, Hitler had unity too. Agree or else. Their thing is agree or get disfellowshipped. Simple. It's not unity. It's conformity. It's not unity. But see, Scripture talks about endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, Ephesians 4:3. It's keeping the unity of the Spirit. There's a unity when we're all recognizing who He is and who He is in us, which is who we are. That will automatically produce unity. See, in our American culture, in our Western mindset, we think that maturity is information. I've been a Christian now a lot of years. I've read everybody's book. I can parrot this and parrot that. But unless it's here, it's not the real deal. Amen. It's not the real deal. Now, jump back to Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. Watch my time. Galatians 5, this is what you look like. This is what Jesus looks like. Galatians 5, 22. Now, the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of who you are, the byproducts of who He is in you, who He is and who you are, what He looks like, what you look like, is love. And that love, and it's fruit singular, which is all wrapped up, and it has also in it joy. What is joy? Are you ready for this? You ought to write these down and meditate on them. Little advice there. It's internal, eternal delight in God, not tied to circumstances. Joy. Internal, eternal delight in God, that's not tied to circumstances. What is joy? Internal, eternal delight in God, that's not tied to circumstances. That's good news. Say, now that's not something you do That's who you are. I'll say that again. That's not something you do. That's who you are.
Amen.
That's not something you do.
That's who you are.
Wow. That's who you are. Glory to God. You know the verses, and I'm just give you a couple of them. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10. Most people know the part of the verse where it says, "The joy of the Lord is your strength." So many times throughout the years, I would try to get joy. Anybody else ever done it? Mm-hmm. Not realizing I already had it. That'd be like me trying to get in this room. I'm already in it. You'd look at me, 1-800 padded truck. Now, let me give you another one here. Go to Psalm 16, verse 11. I'm going to have to move through these. This is so good. Say, this is who I am because I'm in him. And this is who he is. Watch this. Thou wilt show me the path of life. You know there's a path in this life. You do know that. In thy presence is fullness of joy. Now, we talked about this. Do we have to get his presence to come? If you're born again, if you're in Walmart, you're in his presence.
That's it.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. It's just as strong there as when you're reading your Bible. Now, it's important to read your Bible or you won't know these things. But anyhow, thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. That's where you're at. This produces internal, eternal delight in God that's not tied to circumstances. Amen.
Amen.
That's amazing stuff. There's many, many more verses that we could cover here. But I'm going to save some of them, not for the sake of time, because I want to get into it. I want to talk about implementing these things or receiving these things, realizing these things. I'm a nuts and bolts kind of person. How do you receive that? How does that look? So that's why I'm just describing. We talk about what we look like in the spirit. This is what we are. Next one, peace, love, joy, peace. They're all one. Remember that. Here's the definition. Are you ready? Peace, calmness, and rest in a person's soul. It's the absence of strife. The absence of strife. It's this calmness, this peace that's in your soul. What does the Bible say in Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3? Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, or wholeness, shalom in Hebrew. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon thee, because he trusts in thee. And I always looked at, oh man, oh, my mind went off the Lord. My mind went off the Lord. No. God keeps me in perfect peace when my mind is upon him and what he's done and not on me and what I'm doing or not doing. Hear the difference? Can anybody hear the difference? That's a huge difference. Amen. There's so many. In the Bible, he's called the Prince of Peace. Amen. So this say, peace isn't something I have to do to get it. Peace is who I am. Say, peace is who I am. Amen. So love, joy, peace. What about long-suffering? These get good, man. I'm telling you, you're going to love these. What about long-suffering? This is good. The next one, long-suffering. What is long-suffering? Oh, I love this one. It's steadfast patience and endurance that enables us to persevere in spite of difficult circumstances and difficult people. Now, I know nobody's ever experienced that. We're all just, oh, we all glow. This is amazing. This is who you are. This is who you are. I'm going to give it to you again. Steadfast patience and endurance that enables us to persevere in spite of difficult circumstances and difficult people. Wow. Wow. You know, I've said many, many times, and I say it, boy, do I say it. If you or I, and I use myself as an example, if I'm not drawing my life from Christ, there ain't no way that I can do this. There ain't no way. It's impossible. I don't believe it's possible to really do life without the presence of God. I believe, like it's been said many times, that most people live lives of quiet desperation. I believe that. I believe most people are, you say, how's it going? But deep down, it's a desperation. It's something's got to give. Something's got to change. Something ain't right. Amen? I believe that. But see, this is who you are. You're not trying to get long-suffering. You've already got it. See, this is, once you realize this, you talk about developing your spiritual taste buds. Hallelujah. Now, I could give you many, many scriptures on this. Let me give you just one. Everybody say one. 1 Corinthians 15:58. I'll just give you that one. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Golly, time is screaming by. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now, I know we're grace people, but I'm going to say some things to you. Works matter. It matters what you do, not for your born-again experience, not for your salvation, but there are great rewards both here and hereafter for responding to what God has put in you. Amen. See, people are getting grace and they're thinking that it just means, praise God. Adrian, I'm under grace. Hey, God loves you, but you're being an idiot. Amen. What does Creflo say? I like it. He says, when you was acting like a fool thinking you was cool or something like that. Isn't that the truth? But see, Christians do that too. I love one of my Facebook friends said something so good. He was talking about how Satan's your full-service deceiver. And he said for 2,000 plus years, the church has been under a mixture and under legalism and that type of stuff. Now they're finally starting to get a hold of the new covenant and grace. But the sad thing of it is now Satan's coming out with stuff like anti-institutionalism. Like you don't have any relationship with anybody. You just do your own thing. You know, I'm the church, you're the church, your dog's the church, your cat's the church, your toad's the church, we're all the church. Ever heard that stuff? We need each other, people. There's a universalism, inclusionism, all these things that come out. And he quotes on there, he says, Satan is your full service deceiver. He always wants to push you off the other side of the road. Amen? It's so simple, man. But yet it's so profound. And one of the main things that people need is to be steadfast in the things of the Lord. Okay. The next one is gentleness. I'm going to finish these. We got 5 minutes, a little over 5 minutes. Gentleness. Say, this is who I am. Amen. You're not doing this to be anything. We're simply looking in the mirror of God's word and we're seeing who we are in the spirit. See, once you realize, it's a whole lot easier to defend something that you've already got than to try to get something that you don't realize you have. You ever play King of the Hill when you were a kid? Nobody ever played King of the Hill? Thank you, Dawson. Once you get on top of the hill, it's easier usually to fight people off than it is to try to ascend that hill. Amen? Because you got the hill. Now, you still got to keep people off, but once you're on the hill, a lot of times it's easier. Amen. See, once you realize that this is who you are, and the more you realize this is who you are, you're not trying to do something to be anything. I don't have to get peace. I've already got peace. But what if I'm experiencing something that's contrary to that? I need to go to the mirror. I need to find out. Jesus said, for example, in John chapter 14, I believe it's verse 27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not like the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. How does the world give peace? When everything's going good, you're at peace. But Jesus said, I'm giving you a peace, according to Philippians 4, that passes understanding. And you begin to declare that and you say, I have that. I'm not trying to get it. I've already got it. Amen. That's powerful. All right. So gentleness. What is gentleness? Gentleness is warm-hearted tenderness, mellowing that which was harsh. It's kind of like being a peacemaker. It says in James chapter 3 that the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of those who make peace. What is gentleness? This is who you are. You've got warm-hearted tenderness, mellowing that which is harsh. You know what? That's who you are. I mean, I just see the body of Christ. If everyone was operating in this, or at least into some degree, imagine what could be accomplished. Amen. Imagine what could be accomplished. I mean, you could shake the world. I love what Jesus said in John 13, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples, by your love one for another. This is all descriptions of love. What if I operated in a realm where I was constantly mellowing that which is harsh, constantly making light of, oh, they looked at me wrong. Oh, it's no big deal. Maybe they had something in their eye. Yeah, it was me. Get over it. Can you imagine the change we would implement in the world? I'm telling you, you know, Jesus said all men in John 13 would know we're his disciples, learners of him, followers of him, by our love one for another. This is all descriptive of love. This is all describing the love that I have. I'm not trying to get. I've already got it. I just simply need to operate in it. What is faith? Well, I don't feel like operating this. The word says this is who I am. I choose to operate by who I am and not how I feel. See, you begin to do that, and all of a sudden, it becomes, how many days does it take to develop a habit? 30 or whatever. I don't know what it is. It's so many days. But when the more you react to who you are, the more the grace of God flows, and who you are flows out. Amen. But see, the first step is to realize you're not doing, this is it. This is who you are. You say this with me. Say, I am a person that mellows that which was harsh. Amen. Next one, goodness. We're doing great. We're just about done. Goodness means to do good and to benefit others. Goodness involves not just being, but it's a demonstration by actions. Goodness is a demonstration by actions. Goodness is a demonstration by actions. That's good. Amen. I'm moving right along for the sake of time. We're under 2 minutes. The next one is love, gentleness, goodness, goodness, faithfulness. Everybody say faithfulness.
Faithfulness.
Or faith. Which is, what is faithfulness? It's faith. Here it is. Faith. Faith is faithfulness. The word faith in the Old King James should be faithfulness. Here's the definition. Are you ready? Faithfulness, a more accurate definition would be of faith would be faithfulness. It's defined as a steadfast commitment. A steadfast commitment. A steadfast commitment. Do you know what God rewards? Faithfulness. Not ability, not charisma, not talent, faithfulness. I'm serious. There is a reward for faithfulness. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. New Covenant. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2. Verse 1. Look at 1. Look at 1. You don't have to do this to be faithful. You already are. If you're born again, you are faithful. And I don't tell people, number one, be faithful to Him. But see, I've seen so many people over the years, God's calling me to do this, and then He's changed His mind, He's doing this. God's calling me to do this. I'm thinking, God ought to get it together. Amen?
Amen.
Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Amen, brother. Amen. Be strong in the grace. Well, what does that look like? Next verse. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Amen. You ever notice how people, when they just get married, and man, this is the greatest person in the world. You know, they're opening the door for them, singing songs to them, bringing out their little guitar and loving them and doing all this. Then after they've been married for a few years, come on, let's go. What happened? Amen. See, I don't believe faithfulness is just, I believe faithfulness is maintaining the excitement through the years. And that's why when we get to the Holy Spirit, I'm going to talk about that. Excitement, guys, is in the Holy Ghost. Everything that Jesus provided for us positionally is realized through the ministry of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
You ought to write that down. Everything that Jesus provided for us positionally, like righteousness, peace, and joy, is made a reality through the ministry of the Holy Ghost. The flip side of that is without the ministry of the Holy Ghost in my life, what Jesus has made a reality as far as a position is not realized. It's just what I call Christian theory.
That's it.
Amen. Wow. Commit the faith, man. Jump over to Matthew chapter 25. I'm going to show you a couple of verses. Verse 21, 23, 40, and 45. Quickly. I'm going to do these quick about faithfulness. Wow. Hold on. Just about done. We're doing great. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. You know this. Now, thou hast been, this principle is true throughout the New Covenant. I want you to understand that, because That's what's a fruit of the Spirit. These parables. Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Notice, here's what I want you to see. He said, you've been faithful over a few things. Faithful over a few things. Now jump to verse 23, same thing, and then we'll jump to 40. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. I could go into many things. Do you know that we're saved by what Jesus did? Everything's by what Jesus did. But you know that what I do with what Jesus did qualifies me for being usable or not usable? Does that make any sense? I have to qualify myself. Now, I know people think, the universalists go tilt. No, I can prove it to you. I'll just give you the verses. 2 Timothy 2, verse 19 on down. He talks about me purging myself of certain things so I'm meet and fit for the master's use. See, God loves me too much to use me if I'm not ready. I love my son, 5-year-old son, too much to let him drive a car. Amen? Now, someday that'll change. But okay, he's not 5, he's 10 or 11. Jump down to verses 40 and 45. Watch this. I just want to show you this. And the king said unto him, this is the parable of the sheep and the goats, the king shall answer and say unto him, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you have done it unto me. Notice what he says. When you've done it unto the least of these, my brethren, you've done it. Why the least? Why a few things? One more, verse 45, and then I'll say something. Then shall he answer them, saying, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you did it not to one of the least of these, you did it not to me. Notice it's the one and it's the least. Why is that? Because anybody can do it to one who's the most or to the big group. But it takes faith when you do it. I'm just doing this. This is unto the Lord. Amen. That's faith. And when you're faithful in those things, I believe that's what qualifies us for greater use in the kingdom. I know somebody says, that's not grace. That is grace. Amen. That's grace to the max. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness. What's the next one? Galatians 5, 23, meekness. Meekness is simply humility. It's the power. This is so good. We got to get this. I know we're just a little over. It's only 11:30. We're doing great. Meekness is the power or ability to allow God or anyone else to deal with you justly without defending yourself. Whew. That's a mouthful. I'll say it again. Meekness is the power or ability to allow God or anyone else to deal with you justly, that's the key word, not falsely accuse you, but to deal with you justly without you defending yourself. Meekness is when someone comes to you and they talk to you and you say, I see that, I will change. Now, we don't need that in the body of Christ. We already got that. Moving right along. You do already got that. It's who you are in the Spirit. But you know how is in the body of Christ, there's many people you can't say stuff to or they'll go off. Not here, but I'm saying at other places. That's a joke. Why is that? Because we don't know who we are and we don't know who he is. Amen. I mean, I know this message is challenging and it is a chastening. Let me say something to you about the chastening of the Lord. This has been on my heart. Steve Shute preached an excellent message on the chastening of the Lord when he talked about it being child training. But let me tell you something about the chastening of the Lord. If you read down in Hebrews chapter 12 and you get to verse 11, he says, no chastening for the present time seems pleasurable. But afterwards, say afterwards, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. When the word of God is chastening me, I don't like it. That's what he's saying. But people got this idea that, if you're under grace, you never feel bad. I tell people all the time, if you're treating people bad, I hope you feel terrible to the point that you change. That's God. That's the spanking of the Lord. He's not going to run you through a knothole backwards, but he loves you enough to correct you. Now watch this. Meekness is the power and ability to allow God or anyone else to deal with you justly without defending yourself. I'm not going to a lot of verses just because of time. Amen. You don't take reproof over something that's not true. That's not what we're saying. But meekness is the ability to not live in the blame game. Well, I know, but they did this to me. You don't know what they did. See, that's not meekness. That's not who you are. And the more you realize who you are, it's going to be difficult for you to act that way because it's so contrary to your nature. Faithfulness, meekness, gentleness, goodness. And the last one, everybody say the last one, temperance. Temperance is self-control. Many translations translate it self-control. Say, this is who I am. Self-control, and I love this definition. It's temperance is self-control / rigid self-discipline. Oh, come on, man. This ain't grace. This is grace. This is the grace of God. This is who you are. That's the fruit of your born-again spirit empowered by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. See, that's why I say people are trying to be disciplined without realizing in your spirit you're already disciplined. Amen. I'm just about done. These things become ours in our experience. Number one, we recognize our identification with Christ. When we recognize our identification with Christ. Number two, when we respond to the Lordship of Jesus. People say stuff like, well, just make Jesus Lord. You know, that's really incorrect. He's already Lord. The Father already made him Lord. You just accept his Lordship. You hear the difference? People say stuff, oh, just give him your life. We tell people all the time, he don't want your life. He wants to give you his. But I know what they mean. I get it. I'm just about done. We recognize our identification with Christ. We respond to his Lordship. And number three, we walk in the Spirit. Walking in the Spirit has to do with walking in who you are. But I'm going to get into that more as we talk about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Because I want to close with this. What Jesus has made available as far as a position only becomes a reality in your life through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. It does not become a reality in your life through anything else but the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Amen? Amen. Praise God. It's early. We are done.